Greetings class, welcome to this class on brakes. We were studying the construction features and concepts behind how the brake system works in automobile as a part of module 2, and that has motivated us to learn about this anti-lock braking system, usually abbreviated as ABS, which is a part of the same module. We will look at how it works and how it is realized in practice. We learned that wheel is said to be locked if it stops rotating and the vehicle still moves on. Okay, we typically call it as a skidding. This ABS system prevents the locking of wheels. Nowadays, anti-lock braking system is being used in almost all the modern vehicles. This system prevents accidents where one's losing control of the steering is being reduced. With ABS, you will be able to steer the vehicle properly, and it also reduces the braking distance. We will explore all these things. What is ABS? How is it possible to prevent the accident due to braking in this pleasant class session? So before understanding the concepts of ABS, first, let's understand a few things about the steering mechanism. The whole steering mechanism is dependent on a simple principle of wheel rolling. The wheels will always try to avoid slipping on the road. So this means that the velocity of the wheel at the contact point will always be zero. It indicates that the tire which has been rotating on the road, or the rolling of the tire, in the contact surface is the road. The point of contact, at this point of contact, usually the velocity will be zero. That's a meaning of that particular thing, right? So as we move further to this concept of rolling, as I showed in the previous diagram, right? So as a wheel rotates, it rotates along an axis. At the same time, it gives an transition also. It means that the wheels revolve along the shaft, at the same time move in the other direction also. So we have got two types of velocities. One is the top rotational velocity, the other bottom rotational velocity. Along with that, there is a transition that is taking place. The wheels have two kinds of motion. They rotate on their axis and they move along the direction of the car. Due to these two kinds of motion, they have two kinds of velocity, transitional and rotational. For non-slipping rolling conditions, the sum of the transitional and the rotational velocities at the contact point should be zero. Just keep this principle in this mind and you will very easily able to understand the steering mechanism. In an automobile, all four wheels should always be rolling to avoid the vehicle slipping. In fact, this simple rolling principle is a reason why the car turns when you turn in the front wheels. Let's examine this. Assume a hypothetical condition in which even after the turning of the wheels, the car carries straight on the road. In this case, the rolling velocity will be inclined and the transitional velocity remains stayed. Therefore, if we add up these two velocities, the resultant velocity will not be zero. This will cause the car to slip. The only way to avoid this is by making a transitional velocity also inclined. This is possible only when the whole car makes a turn. When the car makes a turn at an instantaneous center, all the four wheels can satisfy the condition of rolling. Therefore, it doesn't avoid a skidding over this position. So I hope you understood what is a rolling part and all, right? So as I said, when the tire skids, the braking distance increases, the steering control is lost, and the tire wear will be abnormal. So now let us analyze the steering mechanism at the time of braking. Due to the brake pads being activated, the wheels stop spinning. Even though the wheels are turned, since they are not rotating, there will be no rotational velocity at all. In this case, the vehicle does not need to turn as its this has become like a normal case of braking. The vehicle will now no longer react to the diverse change to the steering and will slide in a straight line, which can cause an accident. So ABS is a very simple mechanism, as we talked about. What ABS does is to prevent the wheels from completely locking up. This ABS system includes a speed sensor attached to the all wheels. When the sensor detects the wheel is about to lock up, a modulator unit partially releases the brake pad on that wheel. This way, the wheels will be allowed to spin. Intermittently during braking, you can immediately see that the effect of intermittent wheel rotation on the steering. Here, the wheels will have rotation velocity component. This will allow the steering to function as, and the driver will be able to steer the vehicle even during the braking. Now, the big question is here. How does the action of intermittently releasing the brakes reduce the braking distance? I mean, as I said, the ABS releases the brake in a cycles. In the cycle sense, it will see that the brakes are on and off. In other words, the brakes are on and off in a cyclic manner. That's what we call them as an intermittency. And the brakes are applied and then released. The brakes are applied and then released in a cyclic format. So this is what by said. How does this action of intermittently releasing the brakes reduce the braking distance? To get this answer to the question, we need to first understand how the coefficient of friction between the tire and the road varies with respect to slip. In a perfect rolling conditions, the value of frictional coefficient is nearly zero. So this will show us, I mean, that means that we will see this part of things, right? Moving vehicle usually possesses kinetic energy. The brakes convert this kinetic energy into heat by rubbing a disc pad against a disc in case of disc brake, or brake shoe against a brake drum in case of drum brake. Maximum deceleration is achieved when maximum energy conversion is taking place in the braking system, and this conversion is less efficient when the tire is skidding. As I said, when the tire is skidding, apart from losing control of the steering, the cars without ABS face another big issue. Braking on surfaces with different levels of tractions, when the left and the right wheels are on different traction surfaces, applying the brake will generate different frictional forces on the wheel. I hope you got this point. So we're not talking about controlling the steering, we're talking about applying the brakes on the surfaces with different levels of tractions. When the left and the right wheels are on different traction surfaces, applying the brake will generate different frictional forces on the wheel. This will produce a torque. Now you hope you know the torque, right? The torque is what? It's a rotation, I mean, it's a couple, it's a form of a couple, right? And the car will go into an uncontrollable spin. Let us see how this ABS will solve this issue. I hope you understand this point of how the problem is being addressed. We are addressing two sets of problems. One is the avoiding the skidding just by controlling the wheels, wheels on the steering part. At the same time, avoiding the rotation of car when the automobile passes over different traction surfaces. So we get, actually ABS is working on two concepts. Usually we saw that we works on two things, right? One is it does not apply the brakes continuously. Instead, it applies the brakes as a cycles. It breaks down into cycles and then applies and releases continuously, putting up the cycles and controlling the brakes. At the same time, it will try to give a better control on steering also. So we learned about these two things. Along with that, we have to control the spin of the vehicle also, right? So this is a first we need to understand, as I said about the coefficient friction, I hope you got the point. Okay, I'll make it a little bit more clear about those things, right? So first we will understand how the coefficient of friction between the tires and the road varies with respect to slip, right? As I said, in a perfect rolling conditions, the value of frictional coefficient is nearly zero. the value of frictional coefficient is nearly usually zero. That gives us as a true rolling, right? So however, when the wheel is 100% slipping, the sliding friction comes into play. You can expect the frictional values for another levels of slippage to vary this. But since rubber is a complex material with a strange behaviors, which has a very strange behavior during braking system, right? The frictional coefficient between the tire and the road surface and the road varies as shown in this the graph with respect to slippage, right? It has a peak value of around 12% of slip ratio, and below this the frictional coefficient reduces. So during braking without ABS, the frictional coefficient which comes into effect is predominantly sliding friction, which causes the loss of control over the steering, right? So as I said, during the braking without ABS, the frictional coefficient which comes into effect is predominantly sliding friction. However, the ABS, there is a clever algorithm that adjusts the brake pressure to keep the slip ratio to 12. As we said, 12, the slip ratio being 12 is a very critical thing. The ABS takes to control about that 12% of frictional coefficient. Where the friction value is at maximum, this significantly reduces the braking distance. Now back to the huge instability issues of the car. By an intelligent electronic braking distribution, which is a subsystem of modern ABS, one can overcome this issue very easily. The electronic brake system or EBD rate of the car and relative slip of each vehicle is measured. Just by reducing the brake pressure on the wheels with a higher grip, we will able to reduce the frictional force produced by these wheels. This will keep the yaw torque and the whole car under control. So we started talking about the stopping distance. There are a few factors that determine the stopping distance of a vehicle, right? The factors that determine the stopping distance of the vehicle are the magnitude of the force pressing the shoe against the drum governs the distance, governs the resistance to rotation of the road wheel. During this operation, the road surface has to drive the wheel around. The limit of this driving force is reached when the resistance of the brakes equal to the maximum frictional force that is produced by the tire and the road. We call this one as an adhesive force. When this limit is reached, the vehicle begins to skid. So any extra force on the brake shoe will not produce any increase in the rate of stopping, most noticeably on a wet or a slippery surface. The graphs indicate the tire to slip ratio along the coefficient of friction, right? So as we said, 12% of road slip ratio is a slip, very important slip ratio that we need to. We have seen that graph in the previous slide, but we have seen, right? So as we said, when the limit is reached, the vehicle begins to skid. So any extra force on the brake shoes will not produce any increase in the rate of stopping. So during a skid, the stopping distance is increased because of the adhesion between the skidding wheel and the road is less than the given by wheel is on a verge of skidding, right? It means that during a skid, the stopping distance is increased because of adhesion between the skidding wheel and the road. When this is less than the given wheel, that is on average verge of skidding, right? So this is achieved by the use of ABS. We try to gain the stability in case of ABS, that is anti-lock braking system, which prevents the road wheels locking up by momentarily applying and reapplying the brakes, right? Releasing and reapplying the brakes momentarily, right? The electronic sensing arrangements that is used in the ABS for detection of slip can further be utilized to control and limit the maximum traction force used to propel the vehicle. We call this one as a traction control system. So National Highway Traffic Safety Administration defines the anti-lock braking system as a portion of a service brake that automatically controls the degree of rotational wheel slip during braking by doing these following things, right? Sensing the rate of angular wheel rotation, transmitting the signal regarding the rate of wheel rotation to one or more devices which interrupt these signals and generate a responsive control output signals, transmitting those signals to one or more devices which adjust the braking force in response to signal. In whole, it says that we need an electronic system that takes information and brings up, analyzes it and then puts up. The big question here is that how does the action of intermittency, intermittently releasing the brakes, reduce the braking distance, right? That is what been answered here, right? ABS uses a combination of electronic and hydraulic system to modulate the brakes. We are using the term now, modulated. We were using simply as an application of brakes. We started using the term called as a modulation. So ABS system uses a combination of electronic and hydraulic system to modulate the brakes individually to prevent them from blocking. So basically the requirements, the expectation from that functions of an ABS could be a fail-safe system. First, it should be a fail-safe system. Maneuverability must be maintained. Maneuverability says good steering and road holding must be maintained. Immediate response should be there. Brakes applied generally or slammed appropriate response should be there. Operational influences, there should be no reaction on pedal or air control. Controlled wheel, at least one wheel on each side should be controlled on a separate circuit. Speed range of operation must operate all speed conditions. Other operating conditions could recognize aquaplaning, operate an uneven road surface, show slow speed on snow and all, right? So when you talk about the components of anti-lock braking system, the anti-lock braking system basically consists of wheel speed sensor, electronic control unit, or we call it as an ECU, hydraulic modulator, and wheel brakes. So we can see in this diagram that we have put an exploded view of the diagram that can give us a clear picture of what, right? It's a wheel hub to which the drum, within the drum we try to place a sensing devices. So mounting block will be there. To the mounting block we put in a spinning clip and a sensor pickup. These sensors, as I said, we need a wheel speed sensor to detect the speed of the wheels, an electronic control unit to process the data, right, that the input data from the sensor, and give a command to control those things. So we need a modulator. So this is a central CPU, it's an electronic control unit which takes the information from the wheel speed sensor and actuates the hydraulic modulator to have proper to actuate the brakes with an intermittency. So that is the component, the basic component of an ABS. So the wheel sensor, as I mentioned, it is usually an inductive type, which wheel sensors detect the speed of the rotation, wheel lock condition, and signals the ECU. The electronic control unit, a vehicle may have 2, 3, or even 4 channels ABS installation. The ECU is the main control unit which coordinates the functioning of ABS. Hydraulic modulator, as I said, as it's an input, this is the processing part, and this is an actuation part. So based upon the signal from the ECU through the solenoid valves, controls the wheel brake pressure by optimal braking, as I said. Usually the out input is wheel brakes. At the wheel brakes, the braking pressure transferred from the hydraulic modulator serves to force the brake linings against the brake drums, or in case of disc brakes, the brake pads against the brake disc. This is a diagram dissipating the four-channel installation, the four-channel ABS, indicating the sensors with the four-channel system. So one indicates the wheel speed sensor. So we have put up the wheel speed sensor that gives the information through the to the ECU, right? Second component indicates the diagnosis condition. It is a logic maintaining component what we need to have. So power supply is given through a separate battery that runs the entire ECU module. So So we have an input circuit showing how the modulation is going to be done. So there is a digital electronic controller that we call them as an ECU that takes care of taking the information from the sensor, processing it, and giving the logic based on the logic, giving the output to the actuators. So the sixth, we have a microcontroller that takes care of processing part, a non-volatile memory, volatile stabilizer or error store, output circuits, which there are the stages. Finally, we have solenoid wires and pairs that actuates the pressure, relay, stability battery voltage, and then check lamp. All these things control the ABS. So working, when we come to the working part of this anti-lock braking system, ABS works in a closed loop. To be very clear about this, ABS works in a closed loop with a series of inputs and outputs. So we will study about the strategy also, right? We see that ABS means it's going to apply some logic and then it's going to put the brakes in a cyclic manner or put in the cycles to control the brakes. We know that, right? So we'll see what are the strategies to take, right, by learning its working mechanism. The most important inputs are from the wheel speed sensors. The main output is a brake system pressure control by the ECU commands. The ECU compares the signals from the each wheel sensors and measures the acceleration or deceleration of an individual wheel. This part is very important. What it is doing is the ECU collects the information from the wheel speed sensors and the brake pressure control commands. It will see that whether the wheel is going to get locked. How it decides upon the wheel speed, what it is going to rotate, right? Whether it's there is an acceleration or a deceleration of individual wheel. From the data, a pre-programmed lookup tables will be there. The brake pressure to one or more of the wheels will be regulated. From there, it is going to be regulated, right? So this is a block diagram showing how an ABS is going to work. We have a thing called as an ABS control loop. In ABS control loop, you got a hydraulic modulator with solenoid valves, master cylinder, wheel brake cylinder, ECU, the wheel speed sensor. We are talking about this. The reason for keep on repeating about this component is that it could be very simple thing to remember these components. In exam point of view also, it could be a little bit important question from the exam point of view, right? So as we said, it's a wheel sensor, a friction pairing is there, from where the sensor is going to take the pressure, from where it's going to put up back the pressure, right? We have seen the closed loop, right? Should be a closed loop. Through the ECU command, the brake pressure can be reduced, held constant, or allowed to increase. This is a strategy that it can apply, have, right? The ECU command, the brake pressure can be reduced. If the brake pressure is more, it tries to reduce it to the smaller value, or it can held constant. If the right pressure is there, it tries to put up, maintain the same pressure, right? Or it will, if it finds that brake pressure is a bit lesser, it will allow to increase. In ABS, the following variables are sensor used and controlled. That's for having these three strategies, reducing the brake pressure, keeping the brake pressure constant, or allowing the brake pressure to increase. To that, we need some variables, right? Based on that, pedal force. Pedal force is determined by the driver. Whether he applies the brake or brake, something like that. So brake pressure under the ABS action, it can be reduced, increased, or regulated, right? Controlled variables, the actual changes in the brake pressure, or in the words, it's a change in the wheel speed which allows the acceleration, deceleration, and slip to be determined. The variables are three, right? Pedal force, brake pressure, pedal force is determined by driver, brake pressure under the ABS conditions. Controlled variables are the actual changes that takes place in the brakes. Road vehicles conditions, from the wheel speed sensor inputs, the ECU calculates the following things. Vehicle reference speed, determined by the combination of two diagonal wheels, ECU takes it as a reference after the start of the braking. Wheel acceleration and deceleration, it's a real-time measurement which is constantly changing. Brake slip, though it cannot be directly measured, a value can be computed from the reference speed. This decides whether the ABS should be take over the control of the brake pressure, or simply normal braking should be done. vehicle deceleration, the ECU uses the reference speeds as the starting point and decreases it internally or linearly. The rate is determined by the evolution of all signals from the wheel speed sensors. So driven or non-driven wheels must be treated differently. So we should have that particular combination. A logical combination of wheel deceleration or acceleration and slip are used to control variables. The actual control strategy of ABS varies depending upon the operating conditions, right? So this is a diagram. We see what is happening to the pressure part, right? So if the vehicle speed is getting reduced, it senses the wheel speed. As the wheel speed, the tire slip is clip is determined. So based on that, the brake pressure, the brake pedal is depressed. The start of stopping cycle sequence continues. The bottom line shows the brake pressure being varied as a cyclic manner. The top diagram shows them. The top figure shows the variation in the vehicle speed. You see, this is a deceleration that is going to. So at this point, it is going to be stopped. This is stopping distance, right? Stopping distance, what it can do. So in between, what is going to happen? First, initially the pressure is increased. Hold. It's held down. Reduced. Once again, it's held down, and the pressure keeps on varying based on the required wheel speed and the deceleration rate what it has got. Initially, it requires to put a larger amount of force. Initially increases, holds down, reduces, once again holds down, and later on it keeps on varies with a slight increase increment and forms this clip. When there is a tire slip is there, it keeps on reducing the brake pressure. Once again, it means that it is releasing the brake pressure. Further, when the slip is not there, it goes on actuates the pressure, right? So it's clear showing me that. So when there is a slip being occurred, at the time of the slip, there is a releasing of brakes. In other words, the reduction in the brake pedal pressure, indicating that there is a release of brakes. When there is no slip, the brakes pressure is increased, indicating that the brakes are applied on it. Right? This diagram clearly indicates the way the brakes are being applied in case of ABS. So this is a simplified anti-lock flow chart. Initially, the program is initialized with the main speed, within conditions of wheel speed, vehicle speed, and calculations to be done. So system and the controller checks whether to inhibit the channel treatment of ABS. If it is not required, if it inhibits, it stops and applies the normal brakes. If it allows the anti-lock brake system, once again, the analysis system uses the rules of whether the slipping is happening, at what point the pressure, the slipping has been happening. Based on that, analyze the rules for us. Once again, ABS is warrant. If it is warrant, it takes to the state space analysis and valve actuation, electronic mode actuation, and then once again repeats the cycle. If there is no requirement of ABS, it gives a no signal and then puts up a normal braking part only. It's a flow diagram of the program that an ECU maintains in order to have better control using an ABS system. Right. As I said about the strategy, start of ABS section is the first control cycle, smoothening the minor changes in the wheel speed. The threshold of engagement is critical. Too soon, distraction to the driver, component wear. Too late, steering or the stability could be lost on the first control cycle. Even road surface regulations, it's ideal conditions. Adhesion is almost constant. Regulation frequency relatively low with small precision. These are the control strategies what you have, right? Start of ABS action, if it is done, it goes for the first control cycle, then the smoothening. Threshold of the engagement is critical, whether it's to be too soon or too late. But if there is an even road surface regulation, it goes for idle condition or regulation frequency relatively low with the small pressure changes. Vehicle, yeah, that's very important. While braking the different roads, as I said with the initial part, surfacing with a different addition under the left and right front tires, the vehicle will yaw. Yaw is a rotation about an vertical axis. That should be taken care. The ABS tends to reduce this by properly adjusting the brake pressure to the required wheel. Based on individual required wheels, it applies the ABS brake and then tends to control these particular brakes, right? So traction control system is another the part of this ABS system. It works on opposite end of the scale as ABS system, dealing with acceleration rather than deceleration. Some vehicles also use traction control system, that is TCS, in conjunction with ABS. TCS helps in helps the ABS to improve vehicle traction by minimizing the wheel slip on the drive axle during acceleration. If a wheel on the drive axle starts to slip, the traction control system automatically brakes the wheel slightly, transferring the engine torque to the wheel with a better traction. If all the drive wheels starts to slip, the traction control system may also reduce the engine. This is a diagram showing about a traction control system. We have another component called as an ESC, that is an electronic stability control, right? Along with ABS, we usually use an electronic stability program. We call it as a stability program also. Detect the difference between the driver's control inputs and the actual response of the vehicle. When the difference are detected, the system intervenes by providing braking forces to appropriate wheels to correct the path of the vehicle. This is an automatic reaction in the engagement of improved vehicle stability, particularly during severe cornering and on low friction road surface, by helping to reduce the overlap. The implement of ESP functionality, additional sensors may be added. The steering wheel angle sensor will be added. It is used to detect the driver input on the yaw rate sensor, and a low G sensor to measure the vehicle response. This is the advancement that is happening in case of recent vehicles. This is an ESP from the Bosch, what we have got, right? So a logical extension of current ESC, an active steering control function is also there, AAC. Electronic stability control too works on the basis of sensor already used in the ESC, but differs distinctly from the safety point of on the proven ABS, EBD, TCS and AYC functions. This is the ESC, the function and its components, what you have got. As I said, it adds many sensors to have a better control of it. So hydraulic braking, parking brakes is also there. So ESP is a space saving alternate in the EBP, ETB integrated the brake caliper. It consists of an electronic braking system, which is capability of developing own pressure, and electronically operate combined caliper, which is hydraulically pretensioned by EBS and then locked with an electronic magnet. So we have these advantages. In summary, we talk about the ABS, the concept, what is being explained, a typical configuration and working for an automobile have been studied. Along with that, we add an TCS and ESP, that is electronic stability program, as well as traction control system, which has been discussed. I hope with this discussion, we are able to understand how an ABS system is going to work. So we will start with that ends the discussion about the anti-lock braking system. This is a small diagram showing how the brakes are being applied, right? Usually without ABS, the brakes are applied continuously. With ABS, it's intermittently in the form of cyclic. I hope you understood the concepts. Thank you. We'll meet in the next class.